Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 18th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. At agenda item 1, we have consideration of whether to take items 7, 8 and 9 in private. Items 7 and 8 are consideration of evidence we will hear today on a legislative consent motion and an evidence session on renewable energy. Item 9 is consideration of evidence heard last week as part of our inquiry into energy price increases. Do we agree to take these items in private? Thank you. That is agreed. Items 7, 8 and 9 will be taken in private. Our next agenda item is a Scottish statutory instrument. The Companies Act 2006, Scottish Public Sector Companies to be audited by the Auditor General for Scotland, Order 2022 in draft. For consideration of this instrument, Jenny Gilruth, Minister for Transport, is joining us this morning. Minister, welcome. Thank you for taking time out to join the committee. The Minister is joined by Kevin Gibson, Solicitor, Scottish Government, and Bill Reeve, Rail Director, Transport Scotland. Good morning, both. Thank you for being in front of the committee. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. Minister, I understand you would like to make a short opening statement. If that's the case, I will hand over to you.
Thank you. Good morning, Convener, and good morning to the committee. As you and committee members will be aware, ScotRail came under Scottish Government control on the 1st of April this year. And the government-owned holding company, ScotRail Holdings, is overseeing and managing, on behalf of Scottish ministers, the delivery of services by its wholly-owned subsidiary, ScotRail Trains Limited. Now, ScotRail Holdings Limited is a private limited company established under the Companies Act and an executive non-departmental public body. ScotRail Holdings and its subsidiary, ScotRail Trains Limited, were established by Transport Scotland on behalf of ministers to further discharge, to further the discharge of their duties under Section 30 of the Railways Act 1993, with effect from the 1st of April this year. Scottish ministers are the sole shareholder of ScotRail Holdings. As a matter of policy, ScotRail Holdings, as an executive NDPB, would be expected to have an accountable officer as part of good governance, and SRH is not part of the Scottish administration in terms of the Scotland Act 1998. So that means that for the purposes of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000, the Permanent Secretary, as Principal Accountable Officer, is not automatically able to appoint an accountable officer to ScotRail Holdings as a purely administrative exercise. So to enable that to happen, an order is required under Section 483 of the Companies Act 2006, requiring SRH accounts to be audited by the Auditor General of Scotland, which engages the relevant provisions of Part 2 of the 2000 Act, including the power to designate an accountable officer for SRH under Section 15 of that Act. ScotRail Trains Limited will have its accounts treated as part of the ScotRail Holdings Group account, being a subsidiary company in terms of Section 479A of the Companies Act 2006. And as I outlined during an evidence session to the committee in March, we were finalising the chief executive of SRH being designated as the accountable officer at that time. I also confirmed that we were putting in an interim arrangement whereby the Transport Scotland AO would remain as AO for SRH until an order under Section 483 of the Companies Act 2006 is approved by Parliament. This would ensure that SRH would be able to operate from the 1st of April. The S.483 order was laid before Parliament on the 29th of April, and the contingency arrangement, which I've just outlined, remains in place until that order is approved. Audit Scotland were consulted during the preparation of the order. Responses have been confirmed from the Auditor General of Scotland, who is willing to assume the auditing role, and Audit Scotland have helped to assist with best timings for the introduction of the order. And I would seek the support of the committee in relation to this order, which is necessary as a necessary part of the governance process for SRH as an NDPB to fulfil its functions.
Thank you very much, Minister. As you say, this instrument relates to the nationalisation of ScotRail. And when you appeared before this committee less than 2 months ago, you told us that the main reason for the nationalisation was, in your words, to increase accountability, to make sure ministers are held to account. Given that main reason for the nationalisation of ScotRail, do you accept responsibility for the significant service cuts we are seeing across Scotland?
Well, the service cuts that we are seeing across Scotland at this moment in time relate to an industrial dispute between ASLEF, the train drivers' union, and ScotRail, the employer. And ASLEF train drivers, as you may know, convener, are refusing to work on the rest days at this moment in time. As a result, ScotRail took the decision to reduce the number of services because they don't have enough train drivers to fulfil the previous timetable. And therefore, a reduction of the timetable was introduced from yesterday. I have to say, though, that's not what this order relates to today.
It's not directly relevant, my question, to the order, but it relates to the nationalisation of ScotRail, which this order does relate to. Because, as you know, Scottish ministers now own ScotRail 100%, as you said, via a holding company. So the question is, why aren't Scottish ministers getting directly involved in this process to ensure that we don't see massive cuts to rail services in Scotland?
Sorry, Convener, why are Scottish ministers getting involved?
Why are we not seeing Scottish ministers getting involved in helping to resolve this issue?
So 2 points, Convener. I don't think that's an accurate description of what's been happening in recent days. On Friday, I spent a considerable part of the day with ScotRail. And yesterday, I met with ScotRail, along with Mr Reeve, to discuss some of the challenges around about the current situation. It's not the case, though, that Scottish ministers are in the room. Of course, ScotRail, as the employer, will be in the room negotiating with ASLEF. And I think ASLEF will be meeting later today with ScotRail to move talks forward. It's absolutely essential that we get to a restoration of the previous timetable. However, you will appreciate, Convener, that ScotRail can't fulfil the current timetable, or the previous timetable, rather, because it doesn't have enough drivers to do so. ScotRail, like many train operators across the UK, depends upon drivers working on their rest days. Now, drivers working on their rest days is a historic thing that exists in the rail industry. It's not something that's come into existence under nationalisation of our trains. It relies upon primarily goodwill of drivers. Now, I understand that ASLEF are in dispute with ScotRail. I absolutely respect that. They've balloted their members on the pay offer. This is a separate issue because drivers are choosing not to work on their rest days. Now, if drivers want to spend time with their families or take part in leisure pursuits, then that's in their gift, of course. But it's also the case that ScotRail can't run as many trains as would usually be the case under the previous timetable, which is why ScotRail took the decision, the difficult decision, I have to say, to reduce train allocation. And that's why we have a reduction in terms of the timetable at this moment in time. Now, as Minister, I am absolutely committed to working with both our trade union partners, who, as you know from my previous evidence session, I spent a lot of time with in terms of the nationalisation, what that means for them, whether or not they want to be part of that vision. I sincerely hope they do. They campaigned, of course, for a long time for public ownership of Scotland's trains. However, we need to get to a resolution on this dispute, and we need to get to a better place with train drivers in terms of there being availability to work and us being able to restore, ultimately, the timetable. And I'm working closely with ScotRail to see where we might be able to lead to a restoration of a number of services over the coming weeks and months.
Thank you. Final question before I bring in other members. These rail cuts are costing Scotland's economy £80 million a day, which I'm sure you will be concerned about. Mm. Do you have an idea of how long this dispute might last? Do you have a provisional timetable for when you would like this to be settled?
I would like it to be settled today, Convener. However, as you will be aware, ASLEF are in dispute with ScotRail, the employer, at this moment in time. We need to get to a resolution, and I'm absolutely committed to working with both parties to ensure that we can get to a restoration of the previous timetable. But that depends on both sides, I think, coming to compromise with regard to reaching a settlement which will meet the needs of all passengers.
Let me bring in other members. Liam Kerr to be followed by Monica Lennon. Liam, please.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, can I just clarify something that I think you said is a genuine clarification? When you say ScotRail is the employer, is that ScotRail Trains Limited that's the employing entity?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so under this order, the function of Audit Scotland, when it does auditing, it will be doing ScotRail Rail Holdings, and it does ScotRail Trains as a part of that audit. Audit Scotland has power over ScotRail Trains as well. Is that correct?
That's
grand. Can you tell me, so the only question I have substantively, Convener, I sat on the Public Audit Committee for quite a long time in the last session, and it seems to me, or I think there was a report laid at the end of last session by the Public Audit Committee that said they were getting these Section 22 reports coming through. Mm. That were fairly blunt and challenging for the organisations that had been reviewed. But having laid the report, very little was done. So the question, Minister, is that when, as seems inevitable, Audit Scotland lay a Section 22 report on the nationalisation of ScotRail. Can you help the committee understand what will you, as the Scottish Government, and you as the Minister, actually do with that report? And what action do you take in response to that report?
So I might bring in Kevin on the specifics of the legalities involved in this, but of course it would be for Scottish ministers to consider any publication from the Auditor General and to scrutinise, of course, the publication of that material to ensure that we have trains that are running for best value for money, that are meeting passengers' demands. And I think that it will be incumbent upon ministers to scrutinise the detail of that accountability through the reporting process, as happens across a number of different organisations in government. So I don't think there's any difference in terms of the way in which ScotRail Trains, ScotRail Holdings will be held to account via this process, if that answers your question. I might bring in Kevin on the specifics of how it operates elsewhere.
I don't have a great deal to add to that. I mean, the reports are given to ministers, and ministers are then obliged to lay them before Parliament. I think that's how the legislation operates anyway.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Liam. Monica Lennon, please.
Good morning, Minister, and
morning
to your officials. Thank you for your opening remarks. I think people who do welcome the nationalisation of Scotland's rail services do want to see improved accountability and clearer lines of responsibility. So on a point of clarification, I do welcome your intention to have good relationships with the trade unions, but I've noticed that the RMT in the press have accused you of lying, which is obviously not a good allegation to hear. And they also say that the buck stops with you, Minister. So can you explain to the committee on that point of accountability, which is what we're here to look at today, how can the public be reassured that when things are going badly, it won't be a case of, you know, officials and managers will take responsibility, and when things are going well, ministers will take credit? How can we be sure that the lines of responsibility are clear? And how do we get to a place very quickly where, you know, trade unions that I know you respect, you know, have confidence in you and are not accusing you of lying, which is really, you know, a really unfortunate headline to see at this early stage of the project?
Well, I have read in recent days some press reports, as you may understand, and I have participated in numerous media appearances on this, Ms Lennon. I've got to say, in terms of the respectful tone between government and trade unions, the use of that word I don't find particularly respectful. I don't think it's accurate either. I spent a lot of time, as you know, at the start of my appointment with our trade union partners to try and bring them into the conversation about the future of Scotland's trains. They have to be part of this to make it a success. We're not in private ownership anymore. This is public ownership. And the government, of course, is accountable to all of Scotland, not just in terms of ScotRail Trains or ScotRail Holdings. Now, in terms of my accountability, I'm Transport Minister, so I accept responsibility. But at this moment in time, we have an industrial dispute, and it would not be appropriate, as it doesn't happen in any other part of government, for ministers to be in the room taking part in those negotiations. ScotRail is the employer. Now, I am absolutely committed to working with ScotRail to make sure that this works and we get to a quick resolution. I think that's what passengers want to see. I know that's what passengers want to see. I want to see it as well, I've got to say, as somebody who takes the Edinburgh to Fife line pretty much every day into Parliament. So these are challenging times, and I think it's also important to illustrate it's not just happening in Scotland. There are other parts of the GB rail network that are impacted by driver shortages at the moment as a result of industrial dispute. And of course, later today, we'll hear from the ballot with regard to Network Rail and the RMT, which affects a number of train operators. So there are challenging times ahead, I recognise, for the rail network, not just in Scotland, everywhere in the UK. Now, the UK government, for example, can take a view on how it wants to engage with the trade unions. I heard some of that in the press reported over the weekend. I'm committed to working with our trade union partners in a respectful dialogue, which understands that ministers cannot be in the room. But equally, I will work with ScotRail to ensure that we get to a resolution which leads us to restore services as soon as possible, taking me back to the convener's point. We must restore services to allow passengers to get to their work, to go to late night concerts, wherever they may be in the country. And I recognise right now that passengers are scunnered. I said this yesterday. The services that they currently are experiencing are not good enough. We need to restore services. But it's also true to say that we will not get to that restoration of services until we get a resolution between ScotRail and between As Left the Drivers' Union. And I'm committed to ensuring that we get to that place as quickly as possible to give passengers that reassurance they need to make sure that nationalisation is working.
Thank you, Minister. I'm sure we all agree that we need to see that dialogue happening.
And respectful tone as well.
We want it to be respectful. We want to see services restored.
Yeah.
But just my last question, because you've made a distinction between the Scottish Government and what happens elsewhere in the United Kingdom. And the Scottish Government is very committed to fair work. And mm-hmm. I know you have a good relationship with the trade unions on that matter. You did mention rest days, and I think the public want services restored for the convenience of all of us, but we need that to be safe. Mm. So what is the position on rest days? I know you've said it's historic practice that happens elsewhere, but in your mind, is it good practice for workers to feel under pressure to work on rest days?
No, so I would agree with the sentiment of Ms Lennon's question. I don't think any worker should feel under pressure to work on their rest days. But I think I go back to, I think my initial point to the convener, rest day working is not something which suddenly occurred as of the 1st of April 2022. It has been in existence for a number of years. It's how our trains right across Great Britain, I have to say, not just in Scotland, operate. They depend upon drivers volunteering to work on their rest days. Should it be phased out? I think it's a historic practice. I'm perfectly committed to work with the trade unions to have those future discussions as we move forward. However, it is a historic, it is something that has existed historically in terms of how train drivers work and they operate. And I think too, Bill will correct me if I'm wrong, they are compensated for working on their rest days.
They are. It's perhaps also worth adding that the level of rest day working that has been required of drivers recently has been complicated by absence due to COVID-related sickness, and also the fact that although 134 drivers are currently in training in ScotRail, their training programme has been delayed by restrictions. It takes about a year to train a driver, and their training programme has been delayed by restrictions caused by COVID. So a train cab is a confined space, so you can imagine there have been periods when putting a trainee alongside an experienced driver has just not been possible. So it's there's a lot of work to recover that, but the last year or so has not helped.
I imagine we don't have much more time on this item, but I just wonder, ahead of the 1st of April, what advice was given to ministers on these issues? You know, did anyone foresee that this was going to happen, that, you know, services would be reduced by one third just, you know, a month after we moved into public ownership?
No, I don't think anyone foresaw that this was going to happen a month after public ownership. As I outlined to you and the convener and the committee in March, I spent a lot of my time over February and March meeting with the trade unions, listening to them, making sure they were part of our vision going forward. I am still committed to working with them on a number of areas. So, for example, as we know, we've heard from the trade unions' concerns around about their staff and their safety on our trains. There are concerns around about women's safety on our trains, concerns around about what the vision is for Scotland's train going forward. And I want trade unions to be part of that, to feel as though they are part of that. I'm quite clear they didn't feel as though they were part of that under the Abellio franchise. So to answer your point, I think we need to get to a resolution. No, I don't think it was the case on April the 1st we could have foreseen this. I think there were perhaps rumblings, but I worked very hard to build relationships with our trade unions. So I am quite disappointed by some of the most recent press reports we are hearing. But ultimately, we need to get to a resolution between ScotRail, the employer, and ASLEF, the Train Drivers Union, to allow for that restoration of services to come back. And that's what I'm committed to working with both parties on to ensure that we get to that place.
Thank you very much. There are no more questions. The next agenda item is the formal consideration of motion 04466, calling for the committee to recommend approval of this order. I now invite the minister to speak to or simply move this motion.
Convener, formally moved.
Thank you very much. And do members have any further contributions? No. Nope. I now invite the minister, if there's anything else the minister would like to add. If not, we will go to formal consideration of the motion.
Nothing further to add.
Thank you. The question now is that motion 04466, in the name of Jenny Gilruth, MSP, be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. The committee will now report on the outcome of this instrument in due course. I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. That is approved. Thank you very much. We will move straight on to the next agenda item, where we have the same panel as for the previous instrument. Our next agenda item is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum, or LCM, on the high-speed rail crew to Manchester bill. The committee has had a targeted call for views on the LCM, which attracted just one response. It's likely this will be our only evidence session on the LCM before reporting to Parliament. Minister, again, I understand you would like to make a short opening statement, and I will hand over to you.
Convener, I'll be brief. The Scottish Government has consistently supported high-speed rail, but not just to Birmingham, Manchester and Leeds. To realise its full benefit, of course, high-speed rail infrastructure needs to be extended further and faster to reach Scotland. But notwithstanding, we welcome the proposal to locate one of the HS2 train stabling and light maintenance depots in Annandale, so near Gretna, and the highly skilled jobs that this should create. Scotland will also immediately benefit from faster train services upon completion of phase one of the HS infrastructure. Whilst our position is one of support for the bill overall and the depot too, it is also right that we take the time required to scrutinise the implications of legislative consent. This is why the Cabinet Secretary, Mr Matheson, only recommended that the Scottish Parliament give consent to some of the clauses at the time, whilst we were to work through the other issues with our UK Government counterparts. And I am happy, of course, to cover the detail of those clauses along with my officials as part of your questions today.
Thank you very much, Minister. We will now move to questions, and the first question is from Liam Kerr. Liam, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Minister, the Cabinet Secretary has said, look, we're supportive of high-speed rail, but we don't think that we want to recommend supporting five clauses or five elements of it. Can you help the committee understand how have the UK and Scottish governments come to such different views on the extent to which the provisions in this bill require legislative consent of the Scottish Parliament?
So, in the first instance, I may bring in Kevin on the technicalities, but I should say this is a hybrid bill, so there is time yet in 2022 and potentially into 2023 to resolve some of those issues. As you've outlined, Mr Kerr, we are in agreement with the UK Government on a number of the clauses that require legislative consent of the Scottish Parliament. But there are 9 clauses in total that the Scottish Government have identified. And that's in addition to those which the UK Government has asked the Scottish Parliament for legislative consent on. My officials met with the UK Government team to discuss this point after the bill deposit supported by legal advice. And the view of the Scottish Government is that the Scottish schedule, so there are 9 clauses as I've mentioned, relate to matters which alter devolved legislative controls, have a devolved purpose, or for example, they might be in relation to water environment, building standards and planning. So in line with Section 28.8 of the Scotland Act, the devolution guidance note 10, the Scottish Government view is that these clauses require the Scottish Parliament's consent. So many of these clauses relate to land use planning, and planning permission is of course required, and the development of land is regulated for planning purposes. That's regardless of the nature of the underlying project. In summary, I think though both governments have different interpretations of the Sewell Convention, but the practical implications aren't yet clear at this time, but we are working through those issues. As I mentioned, this is a hybrid bill, so over the coming months and potentially into 23, officials are working very closely to try and get to a resolution on some of these issues, recognising our support for the overall purpose of this, but reservations around about some of the specifics that I've outlined today. I don't know, Kevin, if you want to say more on that.
Have anything specific to add to that, I don't think.
But thanks for the answer, but can you tell me what are the practical implications of taking this different view? Because it looks as though people watching this will presumably watch it and say, well, everyone seems to support this, but on a matter of interpretation, there is a potential conflict and potentially, notwithstanding that you say there's time, but potential delay to something that everyone seems to want to happen.
Well, I hope there's not a delay. However, it is, of course, for the UK Government to directly state its position to the committee. But the position they've taken in discussion with Scottish Government and officials in particular is that because of those additional clauses, and they're directly in relation to the authorisation of high-speed rail project, which is a reserve matter, they don't need legislative consent. So they're quite pure in terms of their interpretation of this. They consider that any impact on devolved matters is entirely incidental. So our view is that this is really too narrow an interpretation to, with regard to the legislative consent, given the potentially significant impacts on devolved matters. I don't want us to get to an area of conflict. There are months, if not years, yet to resolve this because it's a hybrid bill. I was in discussion with Kevin about this ahead of committee around about timescales. We were not yet clear from the UK government what the associated final timescales would be because it's a hybrid bill, and it's quite an unusual feature in terms of legislation. And Kevin can say more on that because he's a lawyer. But because of that, I don't want to get us into a conflicted situation. The timescales associated with this are really in the UK government's gift, but what I will say is that Scottish government officials will work very closely with UK government officials to get to that resolution, because we all want this to work.
People watching might be thinking, well, it's not really in the UK government's gift, is it? Because they've set out their position and said that this is the bill, and it appears that it's the Scottish government that is saying, well, we disagree with that interpretation. So it's not really about the UK government, or is it? What am I missing, Minister?
Well, we do disagree with the UK government in terms of their interpretation of some of the legislation, because it overcuts devolved competencies, and we can go into some of the specifics, I'm sure, in the questioning later on today. However, we want this to work, and we want officials to work together to make sure that it is a success. But that shouldn't come at the cost of devolution being eroded, Mr. Kerr. I'm sure as a member of this Parliament, you would agree with that.
The Minister is suggesting devolution would be eroded, but of course that's not... That is the Scottish Government's interpretation of this, and I think that's clear, isn't it? Convener.
Thank you very much. Liam, next up we have a question from Natalie Dawn, who is joining us remotely. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Yeah, I'm just looking for clarification on where we are with the discussions that either yourself or your officials have had with the UK counterparts to resolve the concerns that we've highlighted today in the LCM, and just, as I say, how far along are we, and has there been any progress?
So to answer Ms Dawn's question, officials have been working really closely with DfT and UK government counterparts, most recently on the 19th of May, I think. So it's been really good collaborative working. Also, good progress has been made in respect to the provisions relating to the Crown Estate and Crown Land, and I'm grateful to all involved for that. I hope to be in a position to write to the committee fairly soon on this matter, hopefully later this week. Detailed discussions on the water and building regulations and some road aspects will, of course, follow. As I mentioned to Mr Kerr, this is a hybrid bill, so there is enough time available during 2022 and potentially into next year to carefully work through some of these issues. But these issues and concerns and discussions are ongoing between Scottish Government officials and those in the UK Government.
Thank you. I have no further questions, Convener.
Okay, Natalie, thank you very much. Next up is Mark Ruskell. Mark, please.
Yeah, thanks. Can I ask about two of the aspects here that there's a bit of contention around? And one is about the water environment, controlled activities, regulations effectively not being applied through this bill, which seems a bit odd. I mean, surely there aren't a lot of rivers passing through what is quite a small site. And the other one is around building standards. Are there actually any risks to the environment or to building users for not adopting these regulations through this bill?
So to answer Mr. Ruskell's question, I think whilst it might be normal practice in England to disapply the environmental regulations for major construction projects, that's not the policy in Scotland, as you'll know. The current Scottish Government position is that any potential impacts on the water environment must be authorised by SEPA and carried out in such a way as to protect our water environment to the extent that this is reasonable. In other Scottish infrastructure projects, the requirements of CAR have not been disapplied. So, for example, the Waverley Scotland Act 2006 and the Forth Crossing Act 2011, and hybrid bills passed by the Scottish Parliament, which gave both of them the powers to construct the Borders Railway and the Queensferry Crossing, respectively. The overarching aim, though, of the Building Scotland Act 2003 and building regs is to secure the health, safety and welfare of building occupants. So further details about the depot are needed to evaluate how the proposals would impact on those building standards that would normally apply. Again, that topic will be discussed in detail between the relevant teams, and a position will be reached with the relevant ministers, which I have to say, in this instance, would include my colleague Patrick Harvey, given his responsibilities in this area.
And presumably, I mean, given the size of the site and the nature of the project, these would be fairly simple matters. So, you know, the requirement for the project developer to speak to SEPA? I mean, would that really require a huge amount of work to be done?
Well, I might bring in Kevin on the specifics, but I think the assumption that they should be disapplied is fundamentally wrong. We haven't done that in the past, and we see no requirement for that to be the case here. We haven't yet seen the details, as I say, with relation to the building regs and the depot in Andale. So those details need to be forthcoming for us to reach perhaps a clearer view on that. But Kevin can perhaps say more in the detail.
Yeah, I mean, I think the feature of the discussions at official level at the moment is on exactly that question. You know, what are the practical implications of the disapplication here? Clearly, the bill just takes a blanket approach to these matters, as it does for works in England and Wales, which are far more extensive, obviously. But what we need to get to the bottom of, I think, is, you know, if this were to be disapplied, what would be the practical effect or the practical impact on the water environment, for example? Mm. And we've already set of provisions that are disapplied in Scotland are protections for historic buildings, and ministers have been able to recommend consent for that because we've been able to confirm with DFT that no historic buildings will be affected actually by the works in Scotland. So these are the kind of discussions that are happening at the moment.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you very much, Mark. Final question from Fiona Hislop. Fiona, please.
Acts passed by the Scottish Parliament authorising new rail lines, such as the Waverley Railway Scotland Act 2006, gave project promoters wide-ranging powers to build much of the necessary infrastructure without the need for further authorisation from other public authorities. So you've recommended in the LCM that Parliament should not give consent to provisions allowing High Speed 2 to build the Andale Rail Depot without building standards and controlled activities consents. Is this consistent with previous practice? And if not, why have you chosen to pursue this approach?
So, to answer Ms. Hislop's question, the approach for similar projects authorised by Acts of Parliament is that building standards and the CAR requirements continue to apply. And as I think I mentioned in my response to Mr. Ruskell, both the Waverley Railway Scotland Act and the Fourth Crossing Act conferred wide powers on the promoter to construct the works, but did not disapply CAR or building standards requirements. And given those precedents, we're not in a position to recommend at the moment that Parliament consents to the disapplication of those regulatory requirements in Scotland. But the hybrid bill process in the UK Parliament, as I've mentioned to other members of the committee, is a really lengthy one. So we're continuing to discuss those issues with the UK Government, and I'm happy to keep the committee updated on the progress of those discussions.
And is it your view that it would be preferable that you can come back with an LCM approving consent, should those discussions over this...
Yes, it would be preferable. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Great. There are no more questions. I thank the Minister and officials for taking part in this meeting and providing us with background for our report on the LCM, which we will publish before the summer recess. I will now briefly suspend the meeting for the set-up of the next panel. Thank you very much. a couple of seconds. Just want to make sure you've got some water. And welcome back, everyone. Our next item is an evidence session in relation to our inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering a Net Zero Scotland. Today, we are going to focus on local government's role in expanding the renewable energy sector in Scotland, with five panellists joining us this morning. Good morning, everyone. Three of our guests are in the committee meeting room today. Stephanie Anderson, Head of Regulation, Scottish Power Energy Networks. Randall Brazier, Director of Innovation and Electricity Systems, Energy Networks Association. And Morag Watson, Director of Policy, Scottish Renewables. And joining us remotely, we have David Hammond, Head of Sustainability, Corporate Property and Transport, North Ayrshire Council. And David Roger, Chief Executive Officer, Aberdeen Renewable Energy Group. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for being before the committee. Your attendance is very much appreciated. We've allocated up to around 75 minutes for this session. We'll move straight to questions, but given the size of the panel, we will direct questions to our particular panel members. I'm not sure we're going to be able to address every question to every panel member, so we'll try to keep our questions fairly succinct, and if we could have fairly succinct answers, that would be great. We can make sure we cover all the topics. My first question is a general one, just to set the scene. What are the main challenges you face when dealing with local authorities in terms of delivering net zero targets in your areas of responsibility? And what do you think can be done to address those issues, to help local authorities and to help your own organisations deliver net zero targets for your own organisation, but also generally? And in terms of bringing in our guests, perhaps I could start with Morag, then Randolph, Stephanie, and finally David Roger. So Morag, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. It's lovely to be here. So in terms of local authorities, the work that we do for Scottish Renewables, the challenges fall into two main areas. So the first one is around planning. We need to double, perhaps even triple, the amount of renewable energy generation we have in Scotland by 2045 if we're to meet our net zero targets. None of those projects can be built without planning consent. We have seen the number of planners in local authorities go down by 20% in the last 10 years, just as the level of planning applications around net zero is about to ramp up. We are seeing long delays in the planning system of simply lack of capacity. I would defer to my colleagues in the Royal Town Planning Institute, who are doing detailed work around a work plan development strategy for planning on what needs to be done there, but that is a key issue for us. The other thing that we are seeing, and this is particularly a challenge for onshore wind, we have about 8 gigawatts of onshore wind at the moment. To keep us on track for net zero, we will need 20 gigawatts by 2030. That's just 8 years away. So that is a very challenging target to hit, but one that can be done. But at the moment, we are seeing planning applications taking 7 years. So those two things are just not going to match up. One of the key issues is, although every time we do independent research, we find that onshore wind has an approval rating of around about 80%, with around about 4 to 5% of the population objecting to it. Almost always, if an onshore wind application is rejected, it's rejected on visual impact, on the understanding that people don't like how it looks. But that is not what comes through in the independent research. So we have a real dichotomy there that we're wrestling around with, of how we will reach the levels of deployment we need when we keep hitting up against this barrier of visual impact, which is not supported by the independent research around people's attitudes to these things. So I will not go on any further on planning. I was before this committee on the 1st of February when we said a great deal more about it, and there have been detailed briefings to this committee, so I will not dwell on that one. But the other issue that is going to be a key barrier for us going forward, and this is just one that's starting to kick in, is around the decarbonisation of heat. So heat makes up over 50% of our energy use in Scotland, and we need to decarbonise our homes over the next 23 years. So that is 2.4 million homes and 230,000 non-domestic buildings. Just looking at the homes, if any of you are fast on the maths, that means that we are decarbonising 285 homes a day, every day, 365 days a year for the next 23 years to hit that target. It is a huge challenge. One of the ways that we're looking at doing this is through local authorities leading on local heat energy efficiency strategies, known as LHEs for short. These have been piloted in all 32 local authorities. It is a very useful approach and it is working, but there were some major challenges that came out for the local authorities, and the first one is resourcing. There simply isn't staff in the local authorities at the moment who have either the capacity or the specialist expertise to do this. The expertise particularly falls around data collection and data analysis, around heat use, building types, efficiency standards and so on. That's a huge challenge. To give you an idea, if you commission an external organisation, for example, the Energy Systems Catapult, to do an LHEs style report for you, that's £250,000 ballpark figure you're looking at. So you can understand the capacity challenge for local authorities. The other thing is, this is not statutory. So in a time of great challenge for local authorities, when we have this huge challenge of decarbonising our buildings, where minds are very focused on this, given the current cost of living crisis around energy and particularly heating costs rising, the local authorities are not required to do this and they are having to prioritise, so it's very difficult for them to prioritise this. The other thing that they are going to need is specialist support around how you do this. This is a new area of work for local authorities. There will need to be professional development and support externally. And particularly, there needs to be support to help local authorities work with the stakeholders. And again, I would defer to my colleagues around the energy networks who are going to need to do the grid reinforcements around all of this work. But to strike a note of optimism, there is a capacity hump here. So once a local authority has the staff in place and is able to get something like an LHEs in place, that does enable industry to then come in and invest. So if we look at the example of what's just happened in Bristol, they had their City Leap strategy that they have developed. They then put out to the industry for concessions to do their heat decarbonisation. Vattenfall won that concession for 20 years, and over the next 5 years, they will invest £200 million in Bristol in heat networks and heat decarbonisation. So once we get those plans in place, once there is someone in a local authority to connect with, and they can begin to do that engagement with stakeholders and industry, that's how we then unlock that private investment to bring in the private sector money that we will need to be able to achieve these targets. So I will stop there, Convener. Thank you.
No, thank you very much, Morrigan. You've raised a number of issues which I'm sure members will want to explore later. Randall, if I could address the same question to you, please.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and thank you for having me here today. It's really good to be here. Just for those of you who don't know the ENA, we're the trade association for all of the gas and electricity networks in the UK and Ireland, including colleagues here. So I'll probably raise three quick points, and I'll try not to repeat what Morag said, because I do agree with quite a few of her points, particularly around planning. I think one of the key challenges we're seeing as energy networks is particularly siloed thinking. So what has historically happened with local authorities and planning in general is that different sectors are kind of treated independently. So, you know, transport, heat, buildings, waste, agriculture have largely been treated separately. However, when we plan energy networks, we need to take all of those things into account. We don't just build an electricity network for electric vehicles, for example, or electrified heating. We build it for all of these sectors. So what we think is key going forward is to take what we term a whole systems approach, which is taking into account all of these different sectors and ensuring that when we do planning for energy, we consider all of the users of those energy systems, both for what they need now, but also for what they need in the future. So that is a key focus of ours going forward, and it has to be a key focus of local authorities, because they obviously have a good view of all of those different sectors when they're doing their planning. So that's one point. I think the second point from an energy networks perspective is engagement with networks. So although engagement with networks is improving across local authorities, it is very, very different across the country as to how good that engagement is, and particularly how early that engagement is. There's many examples where there's, say, a new housing block or housing development, but we as energy networks only find out at the 11th hour. you know, water, telecoms have already been engaged with, and we're having to dig up the road for a second time 6 months later. That's just not acceptable going forward. And that goes back to that whole systems approach. But I think engagement with local authorities is key. And leading on from that, when we sort of work with local authorities, and this is something that Morag touched on as well, we often find that from an energy perspective, they have varying levels of skills and abilities. So we think that they need to be adequately resourced from an energy perspective so that they understand energy and understand their needs. And there's a number of ways that you could do that. Obviously, there could be government support, but equally from a networks perspective, within our business plans for the next five-year period, all of the networks, and particularly those in Scotland, have basically put in dedicated local authority support. And there's a range of different techniques for doing that. So some of them are thinking about effectively seconding energy experts into those companies. Some of it is dedicated workshops and support people, and I'm sure Stephanie will talk a bit more about that. So that's absolutely critical going forward as well. They need the skills in-house, either from their own organisations internally, or it could be support from networks, for example. And then the last point, which I won't sort of repeat too much of what Morag said, is around planning. That's absolutely critical. We have to speed up the planning process from a networks perspective. When we're looking about, you know, new overhead lines, new cables, new substations, they can often take years, and we need to speed up that process going forward. That's absolutely critical. I'll end there for now.
Thank you very much, Randolph. And Stephanie, if I could ask you the same question, please.
Thank you, Convener. I am supportive entirely of what Morag and Randolph have just said. However, just to add a couple of points, I think from an energy networks perspective, we do see the planning regime as being probably our key barrier just now in terms of enabling us to meet 2030 targets. And I will provide a couple of specific examples for SP Energy Networks. So, for example, the Beauly-Denny project was a high-profile example where the consenting stage took longer than either the development or construction stages. But most recently, SPEN's application for a consent under Section 37 in relation to the Kendon to Tongland reinforcement, that will enable 1.2 gigawatts of renewable generation. It's currently going through public inquiry, and once we take into consideration all of the work we've done at the start of the stage, around 2 to 3 years, and we include the planning process, by the time we get to the end of that, we expect that will be 7 years. So obviously, with that in mind and meeting 2030 targets, that's something we are keen to work alongside our colleagues on to accelerate the planning regime. In relation to the resources point, I think that's probably what we would see as a key barrier just now. We work very closely with our local authorities, and there's clear ambition within all of the local authorities we work with. Specifically in relation to the local heat and energy efficiency strategies, they are definitely feel empowered to move forward with those. However, I think what we have seen is the lack of technical expertise and resources, again, as Morag and Randolph have touched on. So what we have proposed in Energy Networks, we go through five-year cycles with the regulator Ofgem, where we negotiate what investments will come forward for that five-year period. And we're currently going through that discussion with Ofgem currently. We have proposed what we call strategic optimisers. It's effectively account managers for working with local authorities, where we offer up our technical expertise that the local authorities will not often have. And to give an example of where that expertise has shown real value for customers and local authorities, working with Transport Scotland and two other local authorities, North and South Lanarkshire Council, we rolled out what's called Project PACE. And this was using our dedicated teams of expertise. We worked to look to see where charge points would be most optimally placed within those councils where the market may not deliver. As a result of those additional supports to the local authority, we have saved its £45,000 per electricity grid connection, which equates to £2 million worth of savings just for those two authorities. And if we were to roll that out across Scotland, that would equate to around £26 million worth of savings. So if we work together with the local authorities to complement their expertise, we think that would be a good manoeuvre going forward.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. So it's not the first time we've heard that, the 7 years timeline for project completion, which obviously is a big concern. If I could bring in David Roger on the same question, please, who's joining us online.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me. Again, just a few quick words on AREG for those of you who do not know about Aberdeen Renewable Energy Group. But very briefly, we're in our 20th year as a not-for-profit association with over 230 members. And we are perhaps best known for our work with Aberdeen Bay Wind Farm, working with Vattenfall to help deliver that. But over the years, we've been involved in promoting Aberdeen and the whole of the north of Scotland from a sort of energy capital perspective, with things like the All Energy Show and many other engagements. We're there to support all forms of renewable energy, from wind to solar, from biomass to wave and tidal. And we are seeing a real broadening of interest in the group in terms of not just primary energy, but community and household. And that really does reflect the sort of broad interest in the energy transition. I think AREG is a great example of an organisation that has worked well with local authorities, in this case Aberdeen City and Aberdeen Shire, over the last 20 years. We have supported various initiatives, whether that's it's from sort of heating developments through to new transportation initiatives. And of course, Aberdeen City, very well known for its progress on the sort of hydrogen bus fleet and other sort of incoming technologies. In terms of creating that sort of space of where can we work together, where are the key areas that both an association like AREG, the wider industry, and indeed the both local government and wider government organisations can work together. Some of the key issues facing the industry include investment, grid connection, just in terms of meeting the demand for the future, and also that public acceptance piece. And I'll add a fourth one, which is skills and getting a sort of diverse and inclusive workforce around us as we progress the various projects in the energy transition. I'm going to leave it very briefly at that, because I know there will be other questions and there's some other speakers to follow.
That's great, David. Thank you very much. Let me bring in Liam Kerr. I think Liam has a brief supplemental in this area.
I'm very grateful, Convener. Just on Morag Watson, on your opening remarks, he said that we need 20 gigawatts by 2030. Now, last week, the Cabinet Secretary wound back, so I've just got the official report here, and the Cabinet Secretary wound back on the ScotWind commitment by saying that it was all contingent, reaching our targets on ScotWind was contingent upon the national grid. Now, that rather sounds like getting the excuses in early to me. So, what's your view? Can we actually achieve this, or has the Cabinet Secretary been making promises that can't be delivered?
Okay, so I'll separate out those slightly. So the 20 gigawatts I'm talking about is 20 gigawatts of onshore wind. So when we look at the phasing of the capacity that we need to bring onto the system, in the coming years, we need to be focusing on solar and onshore wind because they can build out fastest. And as we go into the 2030s, that's where the ScotWind projects start to kick in. The Cabinet Secretary is absolutely right that grid is critical around this. And you know, I will defer to my grid colleagues on this. What we are dealing with at the moment is onshore. The regime for planning grid in the UK, the rules were set 30 years ago in an entirely different situation with entirely different goals. They were not designed for net zero. So that is a big challenge, and that is one that we've put to the Westminster government and to Ofgem on a great many occasions. The other issue around ScotWind specifically is there is no grid. Particularly, there is no national grid in the North Sea. It has to be built as we go. And again, it's about how we make the most efficient use of offshore grid, how we don't end up having every single wind farm having to build their own grid connection, how we get a much more integrated and coordinated system. But because these wind farms are building out in different timelines, trying to get everything to match up is a challenge. So can it be done? Yes, absolutely it can be done. Can it be done at the pace that change is happening at the moment? No, it cannot. And that would be our major challenge to Ofgem and to the Westminster government, that the pace of regulation and change around grid needs to pick up exponentially if we are to hit our targets. So those projects that we need to be bringing on wind on ScotWind, it usually takes 9 years to build the grid for those. So we essentially need to start building that grid next year to be able to bring those projects online. So big challenges.
Thank you. Randolph, did you want to say anything?
Yeah, a couple of things. So Morag's 100% right, it can be done, but the challenge is the pace. That's absolutely spot on. You know, it does take a long time, particularly when you're talking about transmission grids and higher voltages to build out the grid. So, yeah, we really need to be able to invest ahead of need and invest basically now to start getting the grid in place for these big projects. We also need to speed up the planning, because it's not just building the grid out, it's getting the planning rights, getting the right routes, getting the way leaves for that, the land ownership rights, etc. But there are also other things that we can do as networks to help get things connected quicker and cheaper. So, for example, flexibility is a key focus of ours, both at transmission and distribution. So flexibility is where we can basically say to a connection, look, you know, we want to connect your full capacity in the future. You know, you'll have the full capacity in the future. But for now, we can connect you for maybe 95% of the time. And 5% of the time, you know, you might need to ramp down your capacity by half during really peak periods. And if you can do that, we can connect you now quicker and cheaper. And then for that 5% where they have to ramp down, they might be able to, for example, pair the wind farm with a battery, for example, to cover that. And that then buys us time to build out the grid. That's one option that we can use. That's called a flexible connection. Another option that we're doing, particularly at distribution voltages, is we're running flexibility markets. So this is where we have a constraint, a grid constraint in an area, and we basically say to the market, we have a constraint in this area during peak hours in winter, effectively. And we will then say to the market, look, can you provide us capacity during that period? Can you provide a service to us? And if you can provide it to us cheaper than the cost of us building out the grid, we'll pay you to deliver that service for us. And that could be a battery, for example, injecting power back into the grid. It could be demand-side response. We're technology agnostic. And again, that buys us time, because we can run that market while we're getting all this planning and consenting right and building the grid out, basically. So, yeah, the planning is key, building ahead of need is key, but we do have these tools and techniques that we can use to buy us time to get the grid ready.
Understand. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Liam, I think Jackie Dunbar also has a supplemental in this area. Jackie.
It's not in this area, convener. Sorry, we miscommunicated. It was for my questions later on.
Do you want to come in a bit later then? Is that
yes,
okay?
Yes, please.
Okay, great.
Sorry, I never...
That's absolutely fine. Thanks for those comprehensive opening remarks. I have a brief second question, because the committee has heard evidence that there's a lack of strategic alignment between and dialogue between local authorities and the Scottish Government in terms of aligning policies and agreeing specific actions to implement net zero targets. We've heard that the targets have been set, the destination has been set out, but there's not a roadmap to map out precise actions in terms of how to get to meet the targets, 2030 as well as 2045 targets. Let me bring in David Hammond, who wasn't there for the first question, or I didn't bring in for the first question. Perhaps I could start with David and then bring in Morag Watson. David, would you be able to address David Hammond? Would you be able to address that question?
Yes, thank you, convener. Good morning to you and good morning to the committee, and thank you for having me here this morning. Happy to try and address that question. I was really listening with interest to colleagues at this morning's session, and it's really enlightening hearing the different perspectives. And I suppose my hope for what I could offer the committee this morning is something of that kind of practical perspective from the local authority at the coalface. Here in North Ayrshire, in terms of our own net zero journey, a huge part of that is a renewable energy programme that we have, a pipeline of projects that we are seeking to deliver to help not only meet the Scottish Government's targets around net zero, but our own local policy objectives as well. And I think what I would like to make very clear this morning is that I have a strong view that the public sector, in particular local government, has a huge role to play in renewable energy generation and a huge role to play in terms of reaching net zero. And that's for, I think, a number of reasons. The level of land assets that we hold that could be suitable for renewable energy generation development. I think also we have a different lens within the public sector to the private sector, a complementary lens, I would say, but we can look at projects, I think, quite differently in terms of not only their financial return, which is important to us because, you know, we're accountable for how we spend that public pound, but also we can think about the non-financial benefits that a project might be able to bring. So clearly, carbon reduction, but also, for example, benefits to the local economy through construction and other job creation, and potential other benefits around biodiversity, for example, depending on the nature of the project. And in terms of our practical experience at North Ayrshire Council, we have at the leading edge of that renewable energy programme that I mentioned, two solar farms that we are seeking to build on two former landfill sites that are since closed. So we're very much looking to bring sterilised land back into use. And I would echo some of the comments made by colleagues just around some of the challenges there. Not so much planning for those two particular projects, not particularly contentious, but certainly in terms of grid connection and grid capacity, that has been a challenge. Scottish Power Energy Networks are the distribution network operator for the area that we occupy, certainly on mainland North Ayrshire. And I must say that Spain have been extremely welcoming to our approaches. They've worked with us very constructively. But I would underline the points made by colleagues that there is definitely further work to be done in terms of engagement between local authorities and a grid network operators to help, I think, a mutual understanding for us in local government to understand the complexities around delivery of grid improvements, grid reinforcements, the timescales involved with that, the complexity involved with that, the resources required. But similarly, for the grid to understand the challenges facing local authority in terms of the things that have been mentioned already around skills gaps. We're operating in an area that we have limited experience of, admittedly. This is a somewhat uncharted territory for us. So I think there is definitely scope for further mutual understanding. And I think there are some practical suggestions around how that might be achieved, shared already this morning from colleagues. And I think around timescales for delivery of our grid connections is definitely a concern for us about really how quickly we can realise those projects and then in turn realise those policy objectives. I think the other point that I would like to make quickly, convener, is around the other side to the renewable energy equation, which is the sale of energy. So again, not an area traditionally that local authorities have operated in, and we do have a resource and knowledge gap there. That being said, how we tend to address that within local government is to procure in technical expertise where it's required, and that is available to us, and we've taken advantage of that. But certainly the complexity of the energy market and how we actually get a route for our projects for sale of energy, whether that's through a traditional power purchase agreement or through more creative means, for example, sleeving, which we're talking to colleagues in the Scottish Government elsewhere around, that is definitely a nut, I think, that local government needs to crack for us to help understand more fully the full kind of business case landscape that we have to help deliver renewable energy projects. So hopefully, convener, that gives a bit of insight into some of the practical challenges on the ground from a local authority perspective. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David, for that perspective. Very, very valuable. Maura, if I can bring you in briefly on that concept or concern about national targets have been set, but there's no particular roadmap as to how to get to the 2030, 2045 targets, please.
You have absolutely hit the nail on the head that we do lack these plans at the moment. There is work ongoing to begin to put them in place. So the LHEs that I've already spoken about, that is the mechanism by which we start to develop those roadmaps of how we're going to get there on heat decarbonisation and energy efficiency. We are beginning to see policy start to emerge. The Scottish Government is working on the onshore wind policy statement, again, mapping out that route map, how we will get there. The ScotWind announcement is very new and very fresh, and again, there will need to be a roadmap of how we get there. And the other thing is that we know that the Scottish Government are just starting to look at a solar energy strategy, and again, that will be needed. Picking up on one of Randolph's points from earlier, our big concern about that is that it ends up being done in silos. We are moving from a space where we had three separate energy systems for electricity, for transport, and for heating, and those are all converging into one system, but we still tend to look at them as three separates. And this is something that we're looking for the Scottish Government's energy strategy to begin to address. In parallel with that, again, picking up on something that colleagues have said, we don't just need to be looking at a roadmap of how we do the infrastructure and the plans, we need to be looking at a roadmap for skills and jobs around this as well. We know as an industry, for example, those 12 gigawatts of onshore wind that we're looking to build, that's 17,000 jobs for the next 20 years after those things are built. So we need to be able to ensure that we have the people coming forward with the skills that we need to take advantage of these opportunities. But again, what we need to see is a flexible workforce that can move between onshore wind, offshore wind, solar, the heating people being able to move around as well. So these are really big challenges, and I would agree with you that this is very much needed. We're beginning to see the green shoots of this work, but again, I would reiterate a point that I think will be made again and again. Speed is of the essence, that we can't be taking 2 or 3 years to develop these things. We just do not have those timescales anymore.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me bring in other members to explore some of these issues. First up is Fiona Hislop. Fiona, please.
Thank you. And on a positive note, the ELHIs have actually now become a statutory requirement just at the weekend following a statutory instrument that the committee passed. So that's a good news item. Less positive, I think, is the challenges facing our distribution network operations. And I've got concerns about the preparation of those. There's going to be a significant increase in electricity required for renewable heat and electric vehicle charging. And if there's challenges now for grid connections and capacity, what on earth is that going to mean for the scale-up that we need? So what, and I'll come to Randolph Frazier first, what is stopping that in advance preparation of networks, and how does it get fixed?
Yeah, so ultimately what was stopping it is that networks weren't really allowed to invest ahead of need. So, you know, we just invested effectively as and when required. You know, it's a bit crude, but it was kind of historically treated as like a TV. You know, when the TV breaks, you just go and get a new one. You don't really think about it. You don't really plan ahead. You just wait until you need it, and then you do it. But you can't really do that with networks for all of the reasons that we described around planning timelines. Now, I think that mindset has shifted. And you've got the Committee on Climate Change, for example, saying we need strategic investment. They say to get to net zero, we need to build it once and build it right, which is what we, you know, which is very much what we endorse. So we've put forward, as the six distribution networks in GB, we've put forward £24 billion of baseline proposed investment in the distribution networks over the next 5 years, from 2023 to 2028. We believe that, you know, that is very much going to be an absolute foundation for net zero. We've very much planned that investment based on net zero, and we need the regulators to approve it. So we effectively need the regulator to approve this strategic investment and do it ahead of need. Once we've got that approval to do it, we then need the planning to be sped up and agile enough to allow us to do it in time. And where, you know, it does take time to build the networks out. It's big, you know, it's big infrastructure, it's heavy infrastructure. That's where we use those techniques I talked about earlier with Liam around flexibility to sort of allow us to buy us time while we do build it out. But ultimately, what we need is the support from the regulator to allow us to invest ahead of need.
And what's stopping that?
Well, I don't. Ultimately, it's up to the regulator to approve it. So I don't think they're necessarily going to stop it. We're hoping that they do approve it. We're waiting for the final approvals in July, I think it is, and hopefully they will approve that for the next 5 years. And if they do, then we'll crack on and do it.
And there's criticism that it disadvantages Scotland yet again in terms of your plans. Have you got any views on that?
No specific views on that. I'd look to my colleague to talk about this Scotland specific issues, but I mean that 24 billion is across the whole of GB. Yeah.
Thank you. And I'll come to Stephanie Anderson now. Is what stage are you at in planning and upgrading the distribution network? What role has Ofgem played in approving and regulating your business plan? What are the challenges? What will make sure that you can provide the capacity and the network capability that we need in advance of need?
Okay, thank you, Deputy Convener. So as Randolph has said, we go through these price control processes, and we have submitted a business plan to the regulator Ofgem just in December last year. Within that plan for the Central Scotland region, we've proposed £1.6 billion worth of expenditure. But on top of that, as you rightly recognise, this is a really agile, moving at pace network, especially at the low voltage side, the directly connected to the customers' homes. So as part of that package, we have proposed to Ofgem that we have flexible mechanisms that are effectively, additional investment will be granted to us as required. So as long as those mechanisms are approved, as long as that £1.6 billion is approved by the regulator Ofgem, we very much stand ready to deliver this from a low voltage perspective on the distribution networks. But there is the other angle, which Mr Kerr picked up on earlier on, from the transmission network side as well, to enable us to connect directly to our customers' homes, to enable these heat pumps and electric vehicles. We need the transmission network to, obviously, the artery in the system to transport that from north to south in terms of the energy flows. So significant work will be required at both our distribution and transmission levels. And from a transmission perspective, it will be the planning regime currently that needs to be a key enabler for us. So for projects to meet 2030 targets, we need to be shovel ready absolutely no later than 2025. So that puts into perspective, we need the regulatory approvals in place, the planning approvals in place imminently to enable that. But we stand ready to deliver. It is really down to regulatory and planning approvals at this stage.
And even from your own organisation, I've heard some sort of basic criticism that you perhaps may not have enough way leave officers, for example, in terms of that planning process. So how are you gearing up as an organisation to deliver this?
And I think that's something, as part of our business plan process, we will be looking at reorganising how we are set up for net zero, depending on what our Ofgem funding is. And that will be released at a draft stage at the end of June, start of July, as Randall said. And at that point, we will look to see how we are structuring our organisation to meet.
And do you think Ofgem will be ambitious enough and fast enough to deliver what you need?
We certainly hope so, and we will see at the end of June and July, and if not, at that point we will be engaging very closely with our colleagues.
Okay, and if I can come to David Hammond, what do you think are the implications of improving those distribution networks for communities and local authorities and public agencies, and what do you think needs to happen to minimise risk and disruption but also keep that pace and ambition that we've heard of?
Thank you for the question. Through the convener, I think the implications for communities are several-fold, because this is about unlocking that potential that I talked about in my previous points around the role that the public sector can play in municipal energy generation. And I think those benefits to communities are certainly indirect through the role that renewable energy generation potential can play in helping meet our net zero aspirations. But there are also potentially direct benefits, again, as I kind of indicated when I spoke previously, around perhaps the different lens that local authorities can look at these projects through. So, for example, working in partnership with communities to help deliver community energy, renewable energy generation proposals, where we would potentially see some of the income from those projects recycled back into local communities, and potentially community organisations co-owning or indeed owning outright their own renewable energy generation infrastructure. That's certainly very much aligned to Scottish Government energy policy in a number of areas, as well as local, I think, policy objectives as well. So I think the implications for communities around that in investment is about unlocking that potential for them to receive those direct and indirect benefits that I mentioned. And I think in terms of the points made just around risk, that is key to, I think, the public sector's role in providing renewable energy generation. Clearly, we are very risk aware as a sector because, you know, of our democratic accountability and our audit and scrutiny of that public pound. And I think that the more that we can de-risk projects and the more that we can understand how projects can be delivered, minimising risk is beneficial. And clearly, when I look at the renewable energy programme pipeline that we have in North Ayrshire Council, right at the top of all of my risk registers are grid connection in terms of capacity, in terms of cost, in terms of timescale. So the investment that's been outlined by colleagues this morning is absolutely welcomed. I think will be welcomed by local authorities, certainly here in North Ayrshire, to help realise and help deliver more quickly our own specific renewable energy projects. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And that theme of de-risking is coming loud and clear throughout this inquiry. If I can now move on to looking at leverage of support and private finance, and perhaps, Maura Watson, with your overview, you might be able to comment on how well you think the public sector currently leverages in support and finance from the private sector to deliver net zero. What do you think are the barriers and hurdles that need to be overcome? And perhaps, you know, do we need to use existing vehicles to bring together in order to de-risk, I suppose, some of the comments we've just heard, whether city-region deals or other mechanisms are needed to de-risk this, but also to generate the huge amount of finance that's going to be required, because quite clearly it will not just be the public sector, it can't be the public sector that delivers this. Morag.
Yeah. So when it comes to leveraging in that private sector finance, we see a really mixed picture across local authorities. And as Stephanie has already touched on, what we often find is there may not be the capacity and the skill set within the local authorities. We are moving into very new areas of expertise and responsibility, and it takes time for the capacity to catch up. Where that capacity exists, we do see a really good connection happening there. So the key thing to say here, that we're in a very unusual situation, and you know, from somebody who has come from the climate change background where there was never enough money to do anything, we're now in a situation where there is a lot of finance looking for investment opportunities. There is more money than there are opportunities to invest it. So what we are seeing is the investment community, their attitude to risk is going up. They are prepared to take on riskier propositions than they would previously have done. So you know, earlier I gave the example of Bristol and Vattenfall, that there's a local authority who was able to leverage in 200 million over the short term and many more millions over the long term, because they were able to bring the skill set, they had a clear plan that reduced the anxiety that any investor would have. It becomes an investable opportunity, and in comes the money. We've seen this happen in onshore wind, we see it happen in offshore wind, we're seeing it happening in solar energy, and it can happen in heat and energy efficiency as well. So it is very much down to there needs to be somebody in the local authority who has this responsibility, who has that skill set, and who has the capacity to go out and start engaging with those stakeholders, because once that engagement starts, that unlocks many things. But I have huge sympathy for my local authority colleagues that, you know, if we ever thought in the climate change sector we were trying to do too much with not enough resource, that is very, very true of our local authority colleagues as well. And this, again, is where we find ourselves on the horns of a dilemma. We need them to have more capacity to unlock this investment. But until they can unlock the investment, it's very hard for them to find the capacity, and we find ourselves in a catch-22 right. situation.
I think that's very well put. Can I just finally ask David Roger, with your perspective, how do you see that interrelationship between the public sector and the private sector in leveraging in the necessary support and finance to deliver net zero?
Yeah, no, it's a really important territory. It's really important to look at this from a sort of Scotland basis as well, in terms of attracting the right levels of investment and the right projects. We're going to see, I think, a very exciting period for Scotland in terms of wind, in terms of hydrogen, in terms of that broader societal energy transition. And I've been fortunate enough also to work with companies like Vattenfall and to see the difference that these kind of projects can make to, for example, Aberdeen with the Aberdeen Offshore Wind Farm, a £230 million investment. And alongside that, and I know it's not a material consideration for the planning process, but alongside that, there is a very good annual fund that the public can bid into, a sort of fund our future fund, which in turn is funding a whole series of community projects and other things that may or may not have taken place. I've seen that happen on the Island of Skye with some of the onshore wind farms as well, and across Scotland. It's a slightly untold story of the benefits of wind farms and that sort of transaction with the public. But just to take a kind of step back in terms of bringing all of these projects through, the planning process is extremely important, both for grid and for the projects themselves, because renewable energy projects should have the same scrutiny in terms of impact on environment as any other project, whether that's onshore or in a marine environment. Something I experienced on Aberdeen Bay, just in terms of that level of detail that needs to be gone to around very many disciplines and studies and analysis of data. There's a big piece that needs to happen to see, for example, the ScotWind projects go through their planning and consenting process. But I think I'd like to connect what we would end up with a successful ScotWind round, for example. You'll end up with a series of world-class projects in Scottish waters, you know, some fantastic engineering ahead in terms of floating offshore wind. And the key bit for me is that if we have these world-class projects in Scottish waters, what we also need to see is a kind of world-class approach in terms of our grid systems and our infrastructure and the way that we deliver this as a combined force. And just a final point for me, which is a bit back to the kind of consultation piece, but you know, we have to take the public with us on these various journeys in terms of helping to join the dots and also helping to sort of synthesise so much information and so many activities happening around Scotland right now in terms of net zero, in terms of renewables, in terms of low carbon, in terms of transport. I could reel off a list from the home area that is probably about 20-23 pieces long. And the point here is, you know, we've got to make sense of this for the public to help them understand the changes that lie ahead, both in terms of primary energy, but also in terms of the impacts on everyday life that appear to be fairly soon down the line.
Thank you very much. And back to the convener.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Next up is Jackie Dunbar. Jackie, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. If I can just follow on from David Roger and David Hammond in regard to the consultation process, I think on a positive, evidence has suggested lately that communities are more than ever motivated to make changes to their lifestyle moving forward towards net zero. But I'm also very conscious that local communities have got a bit of consultation process fatigue, if you don't mind me saying. So they get consulted on an awful lot, but very rarely see the outcomes to that. So if I could maybe just concentrate on David Roger and David Hammond just now, how can you see us moving forward, or the local authorities moving forward, to ensure that they take the local communities with them, rather than just them having the reaction of not another consultation? If I can maybe go to David Hammond first, please, and then maybe David Roger.
Again, through the convener, thank you for the question, Ms. Dunbar. I think the issue that you've raised is really a perennial one, particularly for local government, given the breadth of services that we provide and the increasing, and rightly so, community participation and empowerment that we've seen in recent years, and our desire to understand more and more clearly about what it is and how our communities wish to see our services designed and delivered. And I think the question you raise is absolutely a right and albeit difficult one about how we do that in the most effective way without introducing consultation fatigue. I think there are mechanisms open to local government around that. For example, in North Ayrshire, we have locality partnerships, which are a combined partnership of local democratic representation, so local elected ward members, but also representatives from the local community who come together and meet regularly to discuss issues of local concern, hear proposals and also undertake an element of participatory budgeting as well. So that sort of kind of decentralised democracy is certainly something that we are seeing that communities engage with, particularly younger members of our community, which we very much welcome. Which I think is a positive thing. But I think in terms of consultation as well and how we design that, particularly around our journey to net zero, we're already pushing an open door, I would say, in terms of people's emerging and increasing understanding of the climate change emergency that we're facing. We've had a number of successful area-wide events within North Ayrshire where we've seen massive engagement and feedback in terms of people looking specifically not only to share their views, but also get directly involved. So, for example, we've had a tree planting programme to help deal with carbon absorption for any residual emissions as part of our journey to net zero. And we've seen people across the spectrum willing to get engaged speak with us on that and actually then volunteer and get involved directly. So I think that in summary, Ms Dunbar, it is a perennial question and challenge around how we engage. I think the advantage that we have around the climate change emergency is this is something that is affecting everybody across communities, and particularly with the cost of living crisis that we're seeing at the moment and the pressure on people's energy bills, their attention is even more now on our energy landscape and what we're doing kind of nationally around that. So I think there is a willingness. But I think lastly, the practical drivers around consultation and approaches to consultation have to come into play in terms of us making it easy to consult with people using online and digital platforms as far as possible, as we have been doing clearly through and as a result of the pandemic, and also providing feedback on the points and concerns that have been raised with us in terms of the action that we're taking around that, and closing that kind of feedback loop, I think, is important as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And David Roger, have you got anything you'd like to add? I know that your remit's slightly different to what David Hammond's was, but I'd be interested in your take on things.
I would very much agree the point on design and using technology. I'm probably a veteran of 60, maybe 70 or 80 consultation events from my involvement in renewables over the years. And it was interesting to see how some of the visualisation technology changed, you know, how the developers take the proposal to the public to see things in different ways and to, you know, to challenge the thing as necessary with information and evidence. But also for the developers to present the sort of, the both the environmental implications for the project and to create debate. You know, the consultation events that I've been involved in have been very sort of healthy debates about the sort of merits and perhaps demerits of one proposal or another. It comes down to it for the developers and I guess for the planning authorities and the councils involved to find the right technologies and the right location. I mean, that's for onshore, that's certainly one of the challenges, and for offshore, it's not too dissimilar, finding the right locations for these projects. I think in terms of the sort of public consultation piece is so important to get right, and I think that for the public and the statutory consultees to have their view on these incoming new projects, whether it's wind or hydrogen or local area heating systems, transportation systems, etc. The public have to be kept on side in terms of the timing, the implications, and I guess the visibility around cost is really important here as well. And I'll probably leave it at that on that point.
Thank you very much. I should have maybe mentioned that I'm a former local councillor, so that's why I'm aware of consultation fatigue. If I can move on to the other three panellists, if you don't mind, and ask you in regards to your involvement with local authorities, I know, and other public agencies, of course, if you could maybe tell us a bit more of what your involvement's been, what the barriers have been in regards to delivering the renewable projects. I know that you've all mentioned planning and the lack of planners, but if you could maybe just delve down a little bit more for me, because I think that the lack of planners has been well documented now in the evidence that we've been given, but I'd be interested to find out, you know, what else is there a barrier, but also what's been the positives? What have you gotten out of it, if there's any? And if you don't mind, I'll just maybe start with Morag and then move along.
Thank you. This is a question I may actually defer to my colleagues, because as the trade body, we are representing 300 different organisations engaging in 300 different ways. So it's hard to pull out a hard and fast rule. I've spoken many times about planning, and just to one last point around that, one thing that would be very helpful to my members that doesn't happen at the moment is actually pre-application engagement, where you speak with the local authority and with the statutory consultees as you're developing your design and your project, and if any issues come up at that point, they can then adjust the design as they go. And again, picking up on my previous answers to Ms. Hislop there, this is where we find ourselves in a catch-22 situation, that the officers are so busy dealing with what's already in the system that they can't find the time to do the non-statutory pre-engagement. But once things come into the system and they're asking for changes, it goes back out and we end up going round and round in a loop where you have to iterate the design to meet everybody's requirements. So what has worked very well with SPR colleagues is they, for example, managed to bring together all the statutory consultees, so Nature Scot, SEPA and so on, and Historic Environment Scotland, for a group workshop where they got all the statutory consultees' feedback in one go. And again, to have that kind of workshop with local authority officers where they can work through their concerns that they may have with the scheme, and then before it even hits the design stage, all of that can be incorporated, would really help unblock quite a lot of capacity. But as I've said, this is where we find ourselves in a capacity dilemma, because you need to find capacity to do that initial piece of work that then reduces the capacity that you need later. But finding that initial boost of capacity to do that is very, very trying for a lot of local authorities. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. That's something that I hadn't actually thought on. So thank you very much for sharing that with us. Randolph, have you got anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, a couple of points. So we're also a trade association, obviously, so don't plan directly with local authorities, but we do run some dedicated support sessions for them. So one of the challenges I think that often comes up with local authorities is they don't even know who the networks are or where to start. You know, where do we go to engage? Who do we engage with? How do we engage with them? So we've got some dedicated forums that we run. We call them the community energy forums, where we welcome along community energy groups and local authorities, local area planning authorities as well. And we basically educate them about who the networks are, what they do, you know, what is the grid, how do you get a grid connection, what are the timelines, what are the processes, etc. And what we've also done recently is we ran a big workshop with, I think we had over 100 local authorities there from across all of GB, and we basically are trying to understand what would a whole systems planning process look like across different energy vectors like gas and electricity, heat, transport, etc. So we basically ran that workshop, and now we're producing effectively a whole systems planning tool that people can use and local authorities can use and use alongside networks to understand how that whole system planning process could work going forward. And that's, again, goes back to that whole systems thinking piece that I was talking about earlier, where we can't think about gas and electricity and heat and transport separately. We've got to bring them all together and understand how you plan for all of those options. And, you know, when you are making a decision on something, what is the best solution? You know, do we look at electrification? Do we look at some sort of green gas? Do we look at district heating network? What sort of process would you go through to make that decision? That's the tool that we're working on. That's actually a part of our Open Networks project, which is effectively a project that's looking at how to roll out the smart grid across the country.
And are you finding that you're getting buy-in from all of the local authorities and not just, well, that wouldn't work for us because, or that wouldn't work for us because, you know, is there a joining together?
Yeah, I mean, we had over 100, so that's pretty good buy-in, but obviously there's only a quarter of them or something like that. What we're finding is it's often, sometimes they don't even know about ENA, but they'll know about other local authorities. So once they find out that we're running forums or they hear from other people that we're doing something, they'll often talk to other local authorities and get us involved. So when they do know about us and do get involved, we are finding good engagement. But sometimes it's just that first step is a bit difficult.
OK, thank you. And Stephanie, have you got anything else to add, I realise?
Thank you, Mark. I might just add an example. So I think across the board we have very good engagement. It's fair to say there's differing levels of engagement depending on resources, going back to the earlier point. But we have many different projects that have been extremely successful. Obviously the EV Pace project I mentioned earlier on, £2 million worth of savings just with working together. But even just Edinburgh City Council, Sawston Park, we did a project quite recently where we helped the City Council to install a micro hydro plant. And as a result, they're now saving around £15,000 to £18,000 a year in energy costs. So it's some of these smaller projects that don't make the headlines. We do a lot of these, and various councils we could have replicated examples. So I think these are the smaller things that shouldn't be lost as well. But I look forward to engaging on the LHEs now that that's a statutory requirement.
Okay, thank you very much. I have no further questions.
Okay, great, Jackie. Thank you very much. Next up is Liam Kerr, to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Liam, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. I'll direct my question to David Hammond, but if anyone is interested in coming in, just indicate to me, please. David Hammond, I'd like to develop some comments that Morag Watson made earlier, which I thought was particularly interesting. The committee has heard that the general long-term underfunding of councils, and specifically a lack of funding to deliver net zero, could really hinder process in this space. So is it your view that more resources alone could solve this concern? And in any event, what would it cost for North Ayrshire Council, and if you're able to speak to it, the rest of the Scottish local authorities, to be in a place where they have enough resources to meet the net zero challenge?
Thank you, Mr. Kerr, through the convener, in terms of your question. I think absolutely I would agree with the challenges that have been presented and articulated by colleagues at this morning's sessions around underfunding of local government, particularly around net zero and the different resource pressures that we have and how we need to prioritise our attention. In terms of the specific point of your question around are more resources alone sufficient, I would answer to that question no, I think additional resources are required, but I think that also needs to go hand in hand with skills. And I think that there's a question about how we work with education institutions, how we work with the private sector as well, and how we develop a kind of pipeline of individuals to move into the space, including within the public sector. But I think resourcing and skills development absolutely needs to go hand in hand. But again, I would refer to the whole systems approach, and I would use that term in a different context. It's been used already this morning, but I think it's relevant to your question, Mr. Kerr, in taking a whole systems approach to this net zero question. So resources is one part of that equation, skills is another part of that equation, But equally, if we can meet those requirements within the local government family, there are other parts of the system that need to be addressed that have been well rehearsed, I think, already this morning, around the planning system, around grid connection, grid capacity, grid connection timescales, and the like. So I think we have to take a whole systems view of this challenge in how we engineer the resources available across all of the sectors and stakeholders and actors at play. In terms of your specific question around costs, using North Ayrshire as an example of what resources we would need, that's something I would probably wish to reflect on and to feed back to the committee. I think it's a very helpful question, but I think it's multifaceted in terms of whether that's revenue funding, that will be an element of it, capital funding would be another, and grant funding in terms of specific or projects that we want to deliver in terms of supporting the net zero agenda would be another aspect of that. So I think we would need some time to reflect on that particular question in order to provide, I think, a kind of coherent response. But hopefully that's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you for that response. It is very helpful, Mr. Hammond. Yes, Maura Watson, would you mind?
Of course. So one thing I would add to what David has said, it's an often overlooked thing for local authorities that often the officers do not get the opportunity to network and speak with each other. There aren't always mechanisms to do that. If we look at the example of the Sustainable Scotland network, when the Best Duty for Sustainable Development came in, it was a new area for councils, they were trying to upskill. And the fact that they had that networked body funded by Scottish Government that enabled the sharing of knowledge and expertise between officers across local authorities who were doing similar roles really helped leverage up what was possible. And again, looking at what's come out of the LHEES pilots and so on, and picking up on what Randolph said, that once someone in a local authority finds that something exists and it works, they tend to be extremely generous with their knowledge and expertise and wish to share it with their colleagues, but they don't always have the mechanisms to do so. So in terms of, do we just need additional people? No, as David has said, they also need capacity building, but they need the opportunity to communicate with each other. And that does not happen spontaneously. You need to put in place a structure to enable that to happen, to share the learning.
Very grateful to you both. I'll direct my second question to David Roger, but again, if other panel members can indicate if they're interested in coming in. David Roger, the answers we just heard I thought were very useful, but one of the things that wasn't mentioned but this committee has heard about previously is that a dedicated net zero resource, a dedicated net zero person within a local authority might be key. Do you, in your experience, agree with that, particularly in your interactions with Aberdeen and the Shire Councils? And in any event, are there any policy levers that you, David Roger, think local authorities don't have that they usefully could have?
Contacts at both Aberdeen City and Aberdeen Shire very sort of positively. So I think there are certainly teams and there are people. I think given some of the growth that we've talked about earlier, I think these teams will grow over time, and that more people and different skill sets will be called in to be able to manage the traffic, as it were. I just briefly wanted to reflect actually on the piece around consultation, and in a way it is a lever, and I've just been thinking about this as we've gone through the session, but the opportunity from the developers, whether the councils, etc., are going out consulting with the public, whether it's onshore or offshore projects, there is an opportunity there to include the reference to the sort of overall 2045 net zero target, and almost to sort of kind of give a sense of how that sum total of initiative is adding up, just to provide a context piece for maybe the project, or perhaps even a sort of grid connection sort of consultation if it's a new piece of wire or even a line. So I think that joining the dots is really, really important. So I'm not within a council organisation as such, but I think that
on the lever side of things, particularly considering the public dimension, it's almost, you know, where is the information centre for your net zero ambitions as an individual council organisation? You know, what is it? Is it the web portal? You know, is it an individual personal contact? You know, there are ways of going through all of this with being pretty organised around the sort of information flow, and I guess that goes from everything from sort of web-based information to social media to just the broader media piece as well is really important in all of this. I think if we can get the comms right or communicating with the public, we will take them with us on this journey. And you know, when you consider the things that we're asking the public to accept as changes in the years that will follow, I think that clarity of dialogue, that clarity of information will help to take some of the fear perhaps away. And ultimately, this links to something that we've not necessarily heard the phrase this morning, but the whole sort of just transition piece, the information flow and the understanding and the getting the commitment from the both the public and the business and the council communities, that's really important from my perspective.
Very grateful. Randolph Brazier.
Just the one thing I would add is that on top of the dedicated net zero resource, which we do think they need, they're probably going to need dedicated network resource as well. That's why, you know, and the networks are really willing and keen to get involved and deeper involved with local authorities. And that's why all of them have built it into their business plans for the next 5 years. And hence, you know, we urge the regulator to approve that, because that's going to be critical to get that network's knowledge in there as well. And like I said, range of different options, but ultimately it all comes back to working very closely with the local authority to make sure the energy networks are ready to provide the energy they need to meet their net zero plans and targets.
Thank you. David Hammond, do you have any comments particularly on the policy levers that local authorities might usefully have?
Mr. Kerr, if I could perhaps come in maybe initially on the point just around the networking point that Morag made, which I think is a valuable one. And I think there are a couple of networks out there that could usefully be leveraged further. I think they potentially are likely to mature as time goes on and as we move kind of further into the net zero journey and landscape that we're embarking on currently. We have a Scottish Energy Officers Network within the local government family at present. And I don't think there's a particular focus around renewable energy, but that's something that members of that CEON group, as it's known for short, are actively looking at the moment, and including to develop up a picture of renewable energy generation in terms of public sector pipeline of projects, which I think could then help in turn address some of the conversations that need to be had between local government and DNOs and National Grid, as has already been alluded to this morning. We've also got tomorrow the Sustainable Scotland Network, SSN, which is a public sector organisation, which I'm sure the committee and other attendees this morning will be mostly familiar with. They have their national conference, which I'm attending tomorrow. But I would definitely support Morag's point that more needs to be made, and maybe perhaps to formalise some of those engagement structures that we have within local government. And I would certainly echo the point in our own particular renewable energy projects that we've had, where we've engaged with other Scottish local authorities, but also English local authorities as well. They have been, as we are, very forthcoming with any information, knowledge, sharing copies of business cases, for example, because we don't have that same level of, you know, commercial confidentiality or issues that perhaps exist in the private sector in similar fora. In terms, Mr. Kerr, of the point about policy levers, clearly there have been a number of national consultations of late as the Scottish Government have developed their energy policy, and that's something in North Ayrshire we've been very keen to engage with and respond to and influence where possible. I think the requirement to prepare an LHEES for every local authority is very much welcome. I think also, if I'm not mistaken, there has been indication of some specific resource to help with preparation of those LHEES documents. is on offer from the Scottish Government to local authorities, which I think will be very much welcomed. And I also suspect that the preparation of those LHEs will help local government colleagues to articulate responses to that question that you've asked around what potential policy levers, additional policy levers, that is, that might be welcomed within local government to help on that net zero journey. Thank you.
Very grateful to you all. No further questions, convener.
Okay, thanks very much. Liam, next up is Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Monica Lennon. Mark, over to you, please.
Thanks. Thinking back to some of the evidence we've taken on the national planning framework, I mean, there's obviously quite a major tilt there towards climate and nature emergencies at the very high level. But I'm thinking about how this then translates into local development plans, many of which are, they're all existing development plans. They'll all be going through a period of review and updating. How fit for purpose are those 32 local development plans across Scotland? What's your sense of whether there's enough space and enough policy within those plans to facilitate, 12 gigawatts of onshore wind, maybe, I don't know, what are we looking at, four gigawatts of solar? How fit for purpose? Is there a gap between what the NPF is saying and then what's actually on the ground in terms of those 32 LDPs? Can I start with Morag on that one? And if you've got examples of where you think LDPs are particularly facilitative of renewable energy, that would be useful, or even ones where you think there isn't enough action, that would be useful.
So we see a really mixed bag around the local development plans. We are still under the National Planning Framework 3 regime. We've seen quite a difference in what is in national policy and what comes through in local development plans. You can look very clearly at a map of where onshore wind has been built in Scotland, and you can see very clearly mapping that against the local development plans that are not supportive. So specifically, if you look at Aberdeenshire Council area, for example, there's very little onshore wind, and their local development plans historically have not been very supportive of it. Whereas if you look at something like North Lanarkshire, for example, they have been extremely supportive of onshore wind and now have about £900,000 a year in community benefit coming into the local authority. So theoretically, National Planning Framework 4 will start to address these anomalies and sort of bring some consistency across the piece. Again, this has been a key issue that we have with planning. You can put in two very similar planning applications into adjacent local authorities and get two very, very different results. And what we've always asked for in the planning system is consistency. Please set rules and we will follow the rules, but we just need the rules to be applied consistently and clearly so everyone understands where they stand. So at the moment, as I've given evidence to this committee before, as written in its current draft, the NPF4 will not do that. It will bring more ambiguity and more uncertainty. The top level principles that have been put into it are very good and we are fully supportive of them, but the detail is simply not underneath to bring clarity and certainty to the system that we need.
And is some of that inconsistency, is that down to policy and the way policy is interpreted, or is it down to politics? Will there be some councils where elected members don't like onshore wind farms, reject it, knowing that the Scottish Government might pick it up on appeal and reconsider it?
It's hard to get specific data on that, but we do consider that there is quite a degree of politics goes on within this. And again, this is an interesting area for us, along with our sister organisation, Renewable UK, who operate out of London. Specific research was done in the run-up to the local authorities to understand, does supporting particularly onshore wind impact on how people vote and who they support in a local election? And we found no evidence that it does, but there still seems to be a deep concern among elected officials at local authority level that supporting onshore wind, it's not a publicly supported thing and it's going to somehow affect the public support and that will be reflected in the ballot box. But again, as an industry body, we really, really need to understand how the public thinks about what we do. So this is why we always use the independent research to understand, not from industry, not from ourselves, but from externally, how do people view us? And this is where we keep getting this consistent pattern of very high levels of public support for what we do, But then this dichotomy that in the planning system that is not reflected, and that is an ongoing puzzle and dilemma for us as an industry.
And David Hammond, I'm not going to ask you about the politics of your own council, but is your LDP fit for purpose in terms of the aspirations we now have for renewables? Will that need to go through further revision in order to create greater space for renewable projects, or is it already forward thinking in terms of the targets that have been set and where you want to get to?
Thank you for the question. In terms of our own local development plan, it was adopted in 2019, so we're going through a process of reviewing that at present. And clearly the position with National Planning Framework 4, that will play very heavily into the policy context that we set within the revised local development plan. I think our feedback from a North Ayrshire Council perspective would be that NPF 4 needs to have teeth, try and find a less crude term to put it. We need a very robust policy framework, because where I think things start to fall down in terms of local development plans is if there isn't that backing, and then we get into an appeals process for a particular renewable energy project, etc., where there isn't that robust policy framework to defend what planning application is in question. And that's where, and that's as far as I'm probably prepared to go in terms of a statement on local politics, where the technicalities of that appeal then find themselves. And I think local development plans can certainly do more with that robust policy framework if that is set by NPF4. We need to have resourcing to do that, to repeat that point that's been made already. But I would also make the point that there needs to be, lastly, integration, I think, with the local development plan and planning policy framework nationally with building regulations. So where we are looking at net zero or net zero friendly technologies within property, within buildings, and where a building warrant is involved, I think we need to have a tie in then with planning policy and building standards policy and building regulations as well. I think that would be helpful being tied together. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. And David Rogers, Aberdeenshire has been mentioned already. Do you have anything to add on your local experience of your members in working with LDPs and councils?
Firstly, just on the sort of onshore wind piece, I do think attitudes are broadly changing because of the increased awareness of the impacts and the symptoms of climate change. So I think some of the historic views are maybe there to be re-engaged with in terms of potential other developments. And when I say other developments, I don't necessarily mean large-scale onshore wind. Even community-based wind farm operations are actually very beneficial to smaller groups of people and smaller communities. So I don't think we should disregard those. But in terms of the planning piece, the bit I did want to comment on was just, you know, there is the sort of short-term view, and there is a long-term view for some of this. And I just wanted to flag the work that Nestrans have done in terms of taking a 20-year view of regional transport and creating a strategy there. I can share the link to the document after the session, just as an information for the submission. But what I would say is these are going to be issues that we'll face the generations ahead of us and ahead of those generations. And so we need to be thinking in the long term as well as, you know, the sort of landscape in front of us right now. And I go back to, it was a quote that John Kerry made when he was at COP26 last year. And he talked about the need for unparalleled investment and collaboration to have any chance of abating the impacts of climate change and the symptoms of climate change. And I think that is very true. You know, we have this sort of planetary objective that is all over these plans and these intentions in terms of delivering on a net zero future, just as the sort of starting point. You know, we've got a bit of custodianship of the planet to look forward to after these targets and these years are achieved, to retain a sort of longer term ambition of a more sustainable planet. And I just think that if we can bring
people and technology together in a way that we can make some of this work faster, and then it will be for both the societal, environmental and economic benefit all round.
Yeah, thanks for that. I suppose ultimately it's about getting that route to market though, isn't it, with individual projects as well. So in terms of energy networks then, Stephanie and Randolph, I mean, presumably some of your projects are not going to go near local authorities because they'll be Section 37, they'll go straight to ministers for approval. But where do you see local development plans and that kind of local planning role coming in? Stephanie, do you want to?
I don't think I would add anything beyond what Ms Watson's already mentioned in terms of alignment with NPF4 mm-hmm. and the wider duties. I'm not sure if Randolph has anything to add.
The only thing I would say is that Morag spot on that from what I've seen, it's a completely mixed bag. You know, the reasons for that, I'm not really sure, but it really is a mixed bag. And the level of network engagement in those plans is also mixed. You know, so we would very much advocate for there to be network involvement in them. And then in terms of the sort of overarching national framework, having more detail, I think that makes sense. However, you do need to allow local nuance, because if you're looking at something like heating, you know, you're going to have a real mixed bag. Some places will be electrified, some places may have district heat networks, some places, you know, which may be near a hydrogen cluster, for example, may end up having hydrogen heating. So, yes, more detail in the overarching framework to drive consistency, but equally allowing enough, you know, local nuance, let's say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Final question is about the National Public Energy Agency. It's obviously very early days with that, but as we're talking about development of LHEs and a lot of the coordination and support that's going to be needed across public and private sectors, you'd imagine the agency will have a role to play. Are there early indications about the role that agency will be taking? Any early discussions? Morag, I don't know.
I think the most precise thing we could say about it at the moment is it's an emerging picture, and that is very much reflected across the whole of heat, energy efficiency and decarbonisation policy. It is emerging at the moment. It is our view as trade body that there are some gaps that need to be joined together. And again, we're looking at that gap analysis and speaking with our members. So we expect the local energy agency to be part of the picture and to be one of the key pieces in the jigsaw. But precisely what form that will take at the moment is very much for us an emerging picture. So it's hard to say with any certainty.
Okay. Does anyone else want to come in before I head back to the convener? But Randolph, do you?
Similar view to Morag, to be honest. I guess the other thing is the scope needs to be well defined, and understanding the scope of that versus Ofgem versus departments versus the future system operator, which was also announced in the Queen's speech, etc., is quite critical.
Yep. Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much, Mark. Let me bring in Monica Lennon to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Monica, please.
Thank you, Convener. There's no questions left. It's been a very long and interesting discussion. I want to thank the panel for your contributions. Returning back to the opening remarks from yourself, Morag Watson and Stephanie Anderson, you described planning, I suppose, as a barrier to development, and you described what can be quite a long and slow process. But to put that into some context, do you have any up-to-date figures on how many applications are successful? Because the impression that I have is that it's still very much a sort of pro-development culture that we have in Scotland, and that the majority of applications are approved. Is that fair to say, Morag?
Again, it's a bit of a mixed picture. If we speak with our members who work internationally, Scotland is seen as one of the best places in the world to develop onshore wind. It is well acknowledged that the Scottish Government and cross-party across our Parliament is very supportive of net zero, first country in the world to declare a climate emergency. So this makes us a very attractive place. In terms of things going through planning, one of the things that is quite unique around how onshore wind particularly is treated is in planning system, going to a public local inquiry on a planning application is very, very unusual. but it's very, very common if it's a renewable energy onshore wind application. Anything between a third to two-thirds of them can go to public local inquiry. So those are very long processes. So this is a real question mark that we have as an industry, and something that we are starting to talk to other stakeholders about, is that is a long and expensive process and very demanding on all parties involved. Is there a way that we can stop ourselves constantly ending up in these long legal processes? So, yes, our planning regime is very good, it is very supportive, but it does have some anomalies and it does have some things that we could iron out. What we want, again, planning should always be a test. There is a series of tests that you must pass, and if those tests are clear and you can pass them, you should get your consent. But as we've said, one of the problems is that the tests are not always clear. Sometimes they're open to interpretation. And that can, when you think you've passed all the tests, but it's interpreted that you haven't, then we end up in these long-winded processes where it gets difficult. Mm-hmm. So the clarity is the key thing.
Okay, so are you saying that a disproportionate number of wind farm applications end up in a public local inquiry compared to other development?
If you look at other developments of similar scales, of similar kind of infrastructure, we certainly do see more public local inquiries around around onshore wind. And when speaking to our legal members around this, onshore wind is kind of unique in terms of infrastructure in our country. As the person I was speaking to said, it's big and it moves. There is nothing else in planning that is of a similar scale and also moves. It either moves and is smaller, or it's big and static. So this, again, is something quite interesting in how our planning system deals with this particular kind of infrastructure. And it seems to deal with it differently from how we deal with other things.
Okay. So over the last decade or so, there have been reforms to the planning system. We've seen that in primary legislation, and there's been an emphasis on front loading, so that there's lots of dialogue with applicants, developers, communities, planning authorities at the early stage, and that's supposed to be the place where you can thrash out some of the detail to make sure there is robust information and that is reliable for everyone involved. Is that part of the process working as well as it should? And, you know, as an industry, are you reflecting on what more you can do to build that confidence at the start? Because we know that planning has there's a difficult job to do, to, you know, look at all sorts of competing interests. We know these studies, whether it's looking at biodiversity or flooding, they're expensive, they do take time. Can more be done to front load planning, and is that something that you guys can contribute to?
So picking up on what I was the answer I gave to Ms. Dunbar, it is that pre-application consultation is really, really valuable. The whole consultation process that we have in Scotland, again, it is much admired around the world, particularly the public engagement aspects of it, and people look to learn from what we do. We are, for example, in dialogue with our colleagues down south of the border. They're looking at our guidelines and our good practice guidance around this. So it does work. But as we've seen, when people become constrained for time, they will begin to retrench back into what they are required to do. And that pre-consultation engagement is not a requirement, but it is very, very helpful. So again, this is not about apportioning blame. People have found themselves in very constrained circumstances. You know, we had a financial crisis, and then we got hit by a global pandemic. This has been challenging for everyone. So, these processes do work very well, but finding the capacity to do them can be a challenge.
Thank you. You've made an important point about time constraints, so perhaps I'll come to David Hammond about that in a second. But Morag, earlier on you talked about community benefit funds,
yeah.
And you know, I think you gave an example of £900,000. Do you agree that there is an opportunity for community benefit funding to increase, and that could perhaps, you know, plug some of these gaps that we see in terms of capacity building, engagement, you know, in communities, but also with public sector partners, not just the planning authority, but as we've seen and heard in this inquiry, in terms of the role of local government on the journey to net zero and looking at financing, it does need that cross-sectoral approach. So is there more that can be done to, you know, perhaps make the community benefit funding a bit more generous?
So there's a blend of things that are happening in that space going forward. So as the Scottish Government are considering a target for onshore wind of between 8 and 12 gigawatts, we as an industry advocate for 12 gigawatts. That's in line with the advice from the Committee on Climate Change. The Scottish Government are looking to do a sector deal. So we would expect forward thinking about community benefits to go into that sector deal discussions. So at the moment, the current guidance stands, and that is what everyone works to. The other thing that the Scottish Government has a target around, which the industry fully supports, is that at least 50% of new onshore wind developments that come forward should have an offer of a shared ownership with the community. So for the recent projects that have come forward, that percentage is actually 59%. So again, this is beginning to become rather a familiar message for me. It's around capacity. So while the developers can offer these opportunities, the capacity of a community to engage in them, particularly when onshore wind development can go on over several years, and that's a discussion that the community are trying to engage in over several years, often with people in their spare time in a voluntary capacity, that can be a big ask of a community. So Community Energy Scotland obviously play a very important role in this, helping communities take advantage of these. But going forward, as we've already heard from other people on the panel, particularly David in the local authorities, that actually different ways of communities getting involved, so it's not just that voluntary contribution in terms of finances, but them beginning to be able to have shared ownership, to be able to look at what capacity the developer can bring into a community in terms of their expertise and helping communities reach those aspirations that they might have, whether or not the money that comes via the developer can then be channeled into other net zero things, such as we've seen in Fintry, where they did a huge amount around energy efficiency and so on. So as an industry, we are keen that there should always be flexibility for the community, that it should be about the community having their own aspirations and what they want to do, and what capacity can we bring as an industry to that. So that is always a balancing act between having guidelines and guidance, so everybody understands the rules of the game and there's good practice consistently, but still leaving that freedom for it to be done in different ways depending on what best suits the community where you're working.
Thank you. So we'll turn now to David Hammond. In this inquiry, we have had a lot of discussion about skills and expertise and capacity within local government, and there is lots of good practice to celebrate. But I want to pick up the point that Morag Watson made there about time constraints. And my question's for David Hammond. I can see David Roger on my screen. David, you work in North Ayrshire Council, and clearly the demands on the time of officers across the council are very high. To do the networking and engagement that we've heard about, how do we free up time of local government officers so that they can, you know, engage in that work in a meaningful way? And how do we get to a place where we don't just think of pockets of best practice as being the exception? How do we make sure that we can cascade that across local government and across the public sector so that we can, you know, learn from the best and improve? David Hammond, please.
Thank you for your question, Ms. Lennon, and I think you have really kind of hit the nail on the head in terms of your summary of the challenges facing local government officers. And sadly, there's no easy answers to that particular dilemma. But what I would say is, I think it's a question of prioritisation along with resource. So I don't want to repeat what's already been said about the kind of challenges around resource. We've discussed already this morning some of the options and opportunities to address that. But I think it is also a question of prioritisation, as I've said. And I think increasingly within local authorities, we are seeing net zero and the sustainability agenda coming more to the fore. And I think that's to be welcomed. And that aligns with national and emerging local policy objectives. And to underline that, with an example in my own home authority, we have just had a reshuffle of chief officer remits to include sustainability within that chief officer portfolio, within my own portfolio, for the first time, to give it that profile, that level of attention, and to help divert what available resource there is to that. And I think we need to see more of that across the local government landscape, and supported by elected members. We've got an opportunity to do that, obviously, with new administrations coming into play over the last couple of weeks following the local government elections. I think you also raise a point, Ms Lennon, about best practice, which I think is a really important one. And Morag has also mentioned that as well, and about how we better share that experience and understanding so that other authorities and colleagues don't need to then do the same legwork, for want of a better term, that's already been done. So, for example, I mentioned that we have two solar farms that we're quite advanced with in terms of our planning consent, in terms of our grid connection application, in terms of our procurement process and specification, etc. We're probably in that area on the leading edge of local authorities in terms of those that we've spoken to in Scotland, and we've had several approaches when that information is out there in the local government domain for us to help share our experience, really, to help other authorities develop up their own similar projects. And I suppose what's come to our attention is we've had several of those conversations now. Would it be easier to have that conversation once in the kind of proper forum to share that experience? And I think that does come back to Morag's point earlier about what infrastructure really can we put in place to do that and to help make it more easy for local government officers to find that platform, to share information and receive feedback. And I think that would also help address your point, Ms Lennon, about efficiency then, and about making the best use of officers' hard-pressed time by enabling those conversations and helping them to happen once. And that's certainly a suggestion I'll pick up, and I mentioned my attendance at the SSN conference tomorrow. We've got a few plenary sessions, so that's a question I'll pose to some of my colleagues at the conference tomorrow. Hopefully that's helpful. Thank you.
That's very helpful, David. Thank you for that. I'm also, as you're speaking there, I'm just wondering what morale is like in local government across the board. So when we hear about, you know, planning, for example, and local government being a constraint and a barrier, I suppose that is quite demoralising for those who feel they're probably working really hard and trying to be really helpful. How do we attract people into local government? We've had some really good discussions in this inquiry about the opportunities and the contribution that those working in local government can make to these really important national priorities. And it's not just about those leaving school and leaving, you know, early education at a younger age. How can we attract people in who've got experience in other you know, jobs and industries into local government? And how important is that link between industry, between our education partners and local government to make sure that people know about these opportunities and these really exciting jobs? I think, just to give it a mention, I think there's a solar energy debate in the Parliament tomorrow, so hopefully the work you're doing in North Ayrshire around solar farms can come up. But we don't want that just to be a bit of a secret for those in the know. Again, it's about making sure that is more widely known, and I think people then would feel that local government is an attractive and dynamic place to work. How do we get more people into local government?
Again, Ms Lennon, I think that's a really welcome question, and you'll know it's a question close to my heart as a fellow town planner by background. And I think my own kind of observations on that question would be that I don't think the public sector, in particular local government, is necessarily an employer of choice for those graduating or working their way through higher education, so maybe looking to move into different spheres. And I think that leap from the private, or the exchange between the public and private sector, is generally, or can be, one way. Having made that leap personally from the private sector to the public sector, I think I certainly had my eyes open to the criticisms that I had myself levelled at local government when I was working in the private sector, and found myself with quite different views, experiencing the pressures and challenges facing public sector officers. So I think there is a body of work to do, as you suggest, within the education sector, to help educate around what various roles are available within local government, what local government has to offer in terms of alignment perhaps with people's values around you know, being a public servant, around contributing to issues and challenges facing society, for example, net zero, and how working in local government you can play actually quite an important and direct role in helping to address those challenges. I think that narrative is not yet as existent as we would like within the education sphere, and that's something that I think collectively we would want to take a look at, and how we get those messages in and to help promote local government as an attractive place, which it very much is, to work. And despite the issues facing us that have been articulated already this morning, certainly the colleagues that I work with are very much up for that challenge, very much thirsty for that challenge, and very much putting their hands to the plough in addressing it. So I would say that despite some of the criticisms that have been levelled at local government across the piece, and while that has an impact on officers, we do develop a thick skin in the public sector, as you will know, and we're quite resilient to that. But I think you make an important point about how we flip and reframe that into more kind of positive messaging about helping to be part of the solution. Thank you.
That's really helpful. Thank you. Back to the convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. And Natalie Dawn has confirmed that her questions have already been addressed. So that brings us to the end of our allocated time. Thank you very much for your patience and for taking part. Sorry, the session overran slightly, but we covered a number of very valuable issues. So thank you very much for your insights. And I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow our panel to leave. Thank you. Have a good day. Welcome back, everyone, for the last item of today's public meeting, which is the consideration of a consent notification for a UK statutory instrument. The instrument is the United Kingdom Internal Market Act 2020, Exclusions from Market Access Principles, Regulations 2022, which has not yet been laid. The Scottish Government proposes to consent to this instrument, which, as the Clerk's paper explains, would facilitate its new legal regime banning most single-use plastics. A protocol has been agreed between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to address situations where the Scottish Government is proposing to consent to certain types of secondary legislation made by the UK Government. The protocol sets out how the Scottish Parliament may scrutinise these decisions. There is a statutory requirement that the Scottish Government's consent must be sought for this proposed instrument, and I refer members to Paper 6. I now move to the substantive question for this item. Is the committee content that the provision set out in the notification should be made in the proposed UKSI? Are we agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much. We will write to the Scottish Government to that effect. And does the committee agree to seek further information in the letter we write to the Scottish Government to clarify certain issues? That is agreed. Thank you. And is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a letter to the Scottish Government informing it of our decision today? That is agreed. Thank you very much. I now close the public meeting. Thank you.